This is Duke University.
Okay, great. So, so I'll talk to you a little bit about the work that we've been doing in my group over the past few years on networked systems and how we view these systems and what are the challenges in integrating communication sensing and control. So why network systems, right? Why do we care about these kind of systems? And they're really everywhere. So there are some systems out there that are networked, like the internet, wireless network, sensor network. So we need to think of these systems as networks. We cannot study them otherwise. But also there's a benefit in thinking of standard systems that we've been considering so far. Let's say, like, here's an example of a satellite, and thinking of these kind of systems and replacing them by clusters of smaller agents or robots, if you like, that are going to collaborate and achieve the same task, right? So here's like a satellite cluster. And why is this good? Well, that's good because these clusters, they consist of robots or agents that are going to be cheap and agile, and it will give your system an additional degree of robustness. So if one of these, let's say, small satellites breaks for some reason, then you will still be able, if you have properly designed the whole team, you will still be able to achieve your task that you're interested in. Whereas in the case up there to the left, if your satellite stops functioning, then you need to send the whole mission up in space to fix it. However, when you transition from these like single systems to clusters of systems, then you need to deal with certain challenges, such as that they have limited computing, communication, and power capabilities, and therefore you need to compensate for these limitations by essentially relying on control and cooperation. Right. So this is the reason why to study network systems. And if you think of these systems as control systems, so what is new in this case? So this is a typical control system, right? So you have the plant, which is your dynamics. You have your actuator, sensors, and then the controller, and then you close the loop like that. So when we think about network systems, it's kind of like a similar concept. Now we still have a plant, but now the plant, you should think of it as a collection of plants. All right, so many robots. Each robot has its own dynamics. So I'm going to take all these dynamics and put them in there in this box there up there in the center. Each one of the robots has sensors. So these are the S's. They have actuators and they have controllers, right? So these parts are still there. And then the question is, how do you close the loop? And you're going to close the loop by a communication network, right? So you have groups of robots, and then they communicate with each other. And this network can be wired or wireless. But once you come and you put a communication network in here, what really happens is that now you need to deal with connectivity, interference, delays, and all these kind of things in closing your loop. Right? So there's some interesting problems there. Now these systems, essentially, they're going to comprise of the physical part, right, which is essentially your dynamical system. There's going to be the communication part, and then there's going to be the control part of the system. Okay, so. If we take these different components and we put them together, this is how we view of networked systems, and then there's a number of challenges that one can think about. All right, so first of all, these are distributed decision systems. You cannot assume that there is somebody that's collecting all the information and is doing the processing and then it's sending it back to the agents or the robots. Right, so each one of the robots, if you like, they need to make their own decisions. They can fail. Right, as I said before. So they can fail, and if they fail, then you need to have protocols that are going to be able to reconfigure the remaining group so that you still maintain the operation of the network that you want. They can operate in many spatial and temporal scales, right? So you have certain processes that operate at a certain frequency, and then you have other processes that they're more like event-driven, which I guess is also the other point that I'm mentioning below. They have continuous and discrete dynamics, right? So you have continuous time differential equations, and then you have discrete dynamics, which you can think of them as the event-based part of the controller, for example. There's time delays. You need to think of quality of service in wireless networks, right? So how can you transmit the information reliably between all these agents? There's a trade-off between control design and real-time implementation, uncertainty, and so on, right? So there's many interesting problems to think about. And I'm all, so we're working on many of these issues, and One of the main research thrusts that we have in our group has to do with distributed optimization for these kind of systems, right? So what does it mean? What does distributed optimization mean? So, or control for what matters. So you have essentially a task, right? The task is captured by some utility that you want to optimize, right? So for instance, if I'm a group of robots, then maybe my goal is that we all need to reach an agreement on something, right? So I'm measuring temperature here, somebody else is measuring temperature there, 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 what's the average temperature in the room, right? So that's gonna be your objective. And there's two ways to accomplish this task, right? One is that we say, okay, let's just collect all our information here in the middle and then average it out, right? So that's how we can find the average temperature in the room. Another way to do it is to essentially take this problem, which is find the average temperature in the room, and then decompose it into smaller subproblems. I'm not going to go into details, but now each one of the sensors has its own local utility function. It has its own constraints, and now they need to communicate and run some kind of iterative algorithm in order to find what is the average temperature in the room, right? So communication, there's two ways to do this. One way is to assume that there's somebody that's collecting all the information and is coordinating the rest of the group. So still here, everybody is computing, is doing their own local computation. It's just that there is some shared information center at the middle. And then there's another architecture that you can think of where this green box doesn't exist, and then the nodes, they're just exchanging the information. They're doing their local computation, relying only on their own resources. Okay, so this is the kind of architecture that we think about when we talk about distributed control and optimization. Okay, so that's like a brief introduction of the kind of problems and challenges that we've been working on in our group. Now, for the rest of the time that I have, I'm just going to go over a few projects, some examples, so that you see more explicitly some of our work. So one of the issues that we're interested in, one of the problems we're interested in, has to do with physics-based source identification. So here's a problem. Suppose that you have a source of some contaminant, right? And suppose you are in some complex indoor, let's say, environment, and then there is a flow coming in from, let's say, open windows, and up there you see the velocity field, right? And under the effect of this flow, the source, the concentration that's generated starts moving up like that, right? So this is an advection diffusion problem, right? So the question is, if I have a robot that has a sensor and can measure concentration, right, of, let's say, whatever this chemical or whatever it is that's being emitted from the source, how can I, where should I, like, what is the optimal number of measurements, and where should those measurements be so that I can find where the source is? Not only the source, but I can also find the intensity of that source. All right, so we're interested in ways to do motion planning for robots, to do state estimation and source identification. That's one of the problems that we're interested in. And these are complicated, they're computationally expensive problems. What people typically do is they model the transport phenomenon using partial differential equations, or at least not typically, but one way that people address these problems. And then you need to solve this partial differential equation using some finite element methods, and then that's computationally very expensive. So how can you take these computationally expensive problems that people typically solve on big computers and solve them on an actual laptop kind of computer that you would find typically on a robot, right? Okay, so here's another problem. So let's move away from contaminants and these kind of sources, and let's look at sensors that are cameras, right? So we've worked quite a bit on stereoscopic cameras. These cameras work the way our eyes work. So you have two cameras, one next to the other. And if you have both your eyes open and you're looking, then you can estimate depth, right, to some degree with some uncertainty. But if you block one of your eyes, then you lose the sense of depth, right? So and the reason why you can estimate depth is because you can somewhat triangulate. So that's what you can do also with stereoscopic cameras. And the question here is that if you have certain locations of interest and you want to find what these coordinates of these locations are, and you have a group of robots, each one of them has stereoscopic cameras, how can you coordinate them? How can you optimally assign tasks to the robots? And how should they move in order to take sequences of measurements, which then they should fuse, and then eventually localize all the targets in an efficient way. All right, so that's a problem in state estimation. So the first two projects, they involve mainly essentially sensing and control, but in order to solve these problems with multiple robots, you need to deal with the communication, right? How do the robots coordinate? If two people, you know, you're assigned the job to perform together, you're not just going to go together and do it at the same time, right? Or maybe you will, but you will probably talk before that and you will say, well, let me go there first, do this subtask, you do this, and then we get together and talk, right? So there's this coordination, and this happens through wireless networks. So we've been working quite a bit on controlling this kind of wireless network. So here you see a wireless radio connected to a Raspberry Pi, and then we have a collection of these. So we deploy wireless networks. Then we develop algorithms. How can we efficiently communicate data over these networks, and how can we do that in the presence of uncertainty? And we develop algorithms for that. And here you're seeing some graphs of how these algorithms work. And it's not that important at this point. But then when you go into realistic applications, you have these wireless networks, but oftentimes the uncertainty is such that you're going to lose signal, and you don't know why you lost the signal, and sometimes it's not trivial that you're going to recover it. Or another way to think of the problem is that, well, if we need to communicate, this means that we need to be within a distance from each other, but what if you need to accomplish a task in Chapel Hill and I need to be in Durham, right? So it's very, it doesn't make sense that we're going to go together to Chapel Hill and then come back to Durham, right? What makes sense is that, well, you go to Chapel Hill, I stay in Durham, we don't talk for a while, but then we come back and talk, right? So this is some work that we've been doing in the context of intermittent communication. And the main challenge with these kind of problems is that, well, what if we say, okay, let's meet at 1 p.m. in, let's say, my office, right? And I come to my office and you're not there, right? Because something happened to you, there is delays, right? So how long am I going to wait for you, right? I can wait for an hour, I can wait for 2 hours, I can wait forever, you know, you will eventually come, but then I'm not going to be performing the task that I want to perform, right? So, but then if I leave and you come when I leave, then we missed our coordination point, right? Our communication time, and when are we going to meet again, right? So it's an interesting scheduling problem, and the question is, how do we find such controllers that are going to guarantee that we will be able to always eventually communicate? And then how do we integrate these things with tasks? So regarding motion, so this work is related to motion planning. There's a standard motion planning problem, which is point-to-point navigation, go from point A to point B and avoid obstacles. We're interested in high-level planning, right? So we're interested in problems where, for instance, you have a robot and the task is go to room 1 and collect data of type 1, go to room 2 and collect data of type 2, and then go to room 3 and wait there until some other robot arrives, right? And then go back and forth infinitely often between rooms 4 and 5. Right, so you can specify such kind of high-level tasks. The question then is, how do you design controllers that are going to accomplish those tasks? And if you have a group of robots and you need to coordinate, how do you put on top of that a layer of intermittent communication so that the robots accomplish their tasks and then eventually communicate with each other? And you're seeing some experiments and simulations that we've been doing along these lines. Finally, we've been doing some work also on probabilistic motion planning, again with high-level tasks. The idea here is that suppose that you have a robot and you tell the robot, go to room 1 to collect, let's say, utility 1, but then there's a probability that there's going to be the utility there, right? So you can go, it can be or it there or it cannot be there. And suppose that your robot is moving through an environment and there's cameras, and your task is, well, avoid detection, right? So the cameras are moving around, and if I walk through this region, there's a probability that the camera is going to be looking at this region, and there's a probability that it's not, and maybe it's going to be looking next door. Right? So then probabilistic motion planning is how do you develop these high-level tasks, high-level planners, essentially, that are going to maximize the probability that you're going to accomplish your task, right? And at the same time, they're going to minimize the probability that you're going to violate your constraints. And maybe your constraint is that I get detected by, let's say, the cameras, or I collide in some obstacle or something, right? So this is what essentially you're seeing here, a robot that's moving. It's collecting supplies at these three bases up there. And by the way, there is also uncertainty in motion planning. So one of the applications that we have has to do with micro robots that they're moving on environments, magnetic environments. So this actuation environment is extremely uncertain. So you tell your robot to move forward, but then because of friction and other effects at the micro scale, it can move left or right with different probabilities, right? So in this case, these kind of methods are useful. Okay, so I guess I will conclude with this. This work is of course the work of people in my group, my students and postdocs, and with the support of the Navy and the National Science Foundation.